I'm looking over here because we had one giant holding up this side of the building, and I expected to see the other giant, Richard Wallace, holding up this side. So the next speaker, Richard Wallace, again, there's no one in this room who's not heard that name. One of the other two giants today, there will be others, but Richard has contributed immensely to our understanding of the microbiology of this organism, not to mention clinical care. He is one of the unusual people who has seen patients and also run a world-renowned laboratory. Like Mike Eisman, who's won all the awards on the pulmonary side of things, I would say Richard has won every award on the infectious disease side. And these are major awards, like the Middlebrook Award for Mycobacteriology by the American Association of Microbiology, the Murray Kornfeld Award, Founders Lecture Award, the American College of the American College of Chest Physicians, and the list goes on and on. But again, I gave you a little insight into Mike Eisman. I was told, Richard is not the fastest guy on the email response, and he's not the easiest guy to get on the telephone. But I was told there's a code word, and I'm going to share it with you now, that if I called his lab and said soccer, they would go, oh, okay, we'll get him. Because a big part of his life has been a soccer. He loves soccer. He's a referee in soccer. The other big part of his life, which has brought him to Colorado many, many times, is fly fishing. Just a little personal insights into another one of the giants in the field of NTM. Richard.
Thank you, Chuck. I'm flooded with memories when I come here, and I'll give you a taste of that in a minute. There's an old saying which I just told Mike, which is goes something like, if you don't remember the past, you're doomed to repeat your failures. The past is very important to us, and especially as guys like Mike and I get older, we remember how we got here. What we started with and what we're looking at now. From a laboratory standpoint, this is absolutely the most exciting time we have ever had. The limitations for us at this point in time are minimal compared to what we've faced in the past. I mean, I remember my beginning in which I did all of my own lab work. I wrote all my own papers, and then I went to clinic. And most of us who were involved in NTM, that's what we did. We had another job somewhere, and then we worked our way in there. So, let's see if I can make this work here. Oops. Oh, I do have, these are my, I wouldn't call them conflicts, but they are companies that we're involved with. Like Mike said, I wish that list was as long as my arm. Because I'm not concerned about that those companies will influence what we do. But they've been a major source of funding for us for many, many years. And the concern that this is will influence us in the wrong way has basically turned off completely this particular source of funding. And it's very important because the NIH has been limited in their support of the kinds of work that people in NTM have been doing. So like Mike said, I wish this list went all the way down to the bottom of the page. I'm not sure how it got up to the top there, but this is, the question is, do you know these people? I don't know if you recognize the guy on the left, but that was what? more than 30 years ago. All of us have mentors, and we've talked about how each of us has been touched by individuals. And we talk to the young people now and tell them how important it is to find a mentor who's been through the mill and can give you some guidance. My major mentor was a man named Manny Walensky, who had a beginning much like everybody else. He was a physician, developed active tuberculosis, and was sent to the Trudeau Sanitarium in Upper New York State. When he felt better, they had a little lab there. He went to work there and really became a dominant force in NTM. How he quite got there, I don't know, but he, every time I went to a meeting, this guy looked me up and talked to me and asked me what I was doing and showed real interest, in which I thought nobody else really cared. That's why guys like Mike and Leonid are so important. They are the fathers of many of the older people who are going to stand up here and many of the younger people, and how important that tradition is to continue. Now, the lady over here, if any of you ever tried to get a hold of me, this is Barbara Elliott, who runs the lab and has worked for me for more than 25 years. She always answers her emails, and she always answers the phone, so.
She's the one who told me to say soccer.
Yeah. Let's see. The title of this talk about what's in a name, perhaps reflects the past about what microbiology was. The interest was largely in, for the lab, what do I have? What's the name of this thing? And really, that's what we did. Susceptibilities didn't mean a whole lot. This is true for NTM. It's just, do I have MAC? Do I have M. abscessus? And that's about it. But times have changed. The lab, along with times, is changing dramatically. I have more people working in my microbiology lab whose background is molecular biology and know little or nothing about microbiology I have to teach them than there are people whose background as technologists in microbiology. That's the direction all laboratories are going, including ours. It's not a totally bad thing, but it is a definite transmission. So when you call the lab, sometimes the person who answers, you ask him about M. xenopi or M. simiae, there's going to be a long pause, and they'll say, let me find somebody else, because they don't know that. They know how to run these machines and do some of these tests we're going to talk about, but their knowledge is very limited. So we really have a mixed bag of what's taking place in the laboratory and is really changing how we do business. Really cool that Paul Davidson's name was mentioned. I attended an international conference on atypical mycobacteria, which is held at National Jewish in 1979. I presented my first paper on non-tuberculous mycobacteria, and I met the giants of the time, none of whom I knew. I was probably, well, you can do the math, it was a long time ago. But what, I was just like, oh, this is just great to hear these names. And I still go back, and this was published in a journal, and look at the topics and the titles. But I was struck specifically in the preface to this was a comment made by Paul Davidson, who was the sort of sponsor or director for that issue of the journal. This is what he said. The taxonomy of mycobacteria with its attendant methods for classification and identifications has developed intensely over the years. Several papers included in these proceedings convince us that taxonomy has become well established. What is left are the minor details of further refinement. Well, he was right on for the first three sentences. At this time, I counted the number of NTM that he listed in this preface. There were 14. It's now 150. And if you look at these, the rate at which these new species are appearing, there were only 25 species in this first 80 years. Paul didn't list all of them. He listed the human pathogens, those that cause disease, and some of the others that were listed did not cause human disease. And I will tell you of this list, only about half of them have ever been associated with humans. But if you look, the time period gets shorter and shorter, and the number gets bigger and bigger. And we're now to the point that we see one or two new species every year. Some of this has to do with better laboratory techniques. We obviously do better at growing organisms. We have different kinds of methodologies, which I'm not going to spend a lot of time on. The biggest advance has been that identification of organisms now in the developed world is based on molecular technology. Not in undeveloped countries, but essentially all the people up here who are involved in the laboratory use molecular techniques so that within generally one day of doing the test, we can give you an answer about what it is or what it isn't. The old days, we had to grow it and do these tests. You know, a month or 6 weeks was the routine. Now, potentially, it's as short as a day. Let me get, I'm going to get or pay attention now to just a small number of these species and recent changes that I think are important. The role of the microbiology laboratory has changed in a major way. The scientific advances that are made in terms of studying epidemiology, studying the organisms and their pathogenicity, are now part of the microbiology laboratory. They're not routinely done, but we're more than just do a stain and grow the organism. And you'll see that some of the things that we talk about all are now still related to what we call the microbiology laboratory. It's just what we do has changed fairly dramatically. MAC, which many of you probably think is one organism, is in fact not one organism. With molecular technology, we have identified at least 10, actually I guess it's 8, but it's 8 different species. What does a species mean? Well, it's not that easy to tell you, but suffice it to say that each of these species generally has a different biologic behavior. And in patients, it may behave differently. Mycobacterium avium, Mycobacterium intracellulare, those are the names of the two oldest, most recognized species. They are far and away the most aggressive in terms of causing clinical disease. So what's important about these other species? Well, if I tell you they're not very aggressive, and knowing that they're present may alter what you do, recognizing that these not so pathogenic organisms are present is very important to you and the clinician when you make decisions. We have not identified these organisms on any regular basis in the past, and I'm going to give you an example of how it has really changed what we do. It is a struggle for laboratories to decide, are they at a place that they need to do this? Certainly, laboratories that do research, you're going to have a hard time publishing an article if you don't identify which organism you're working with. I mean, this is part of the change that's taking place. We don't know that, for example, M. avium behaves differently in whatever study you're doing, but if you mix them all together, we may never know. And we're saying that you can't do that anymore. I'm going to talk about two organisms, both of which I can virtually guarantee that no one in this room who is a patient has ever heard of. Probably some of the physicians haven't either. And it's an example of how the laboratory and the organisms of the laboratory have changed. One of these is called Mycobacterium chimera. One of these is called Mycobacterium mycelliense. And the last thing I'm going to talk about is something called whole genomic sequencing. This is a reminder, and I think Rachel Thompson is going to explain this a whole lot more. This is part of where the laboratory has helped, because we've answered a big part of the question about where cometh Mac. And this is where cometh Mac. This is your household plumbing. This is the plumbing that comes from the commercial water supply from wherever you get your water. Not just your house, but everybody else's house who derives water from that source. Actually, please ignore the name on the bottom because I didn't ask permission to use this slide. We should have cut that off. These days you can't do that. But it's a great picture of what our pipes look like. And those are probably modern pipes. But you'll note that there are probably three or four different kinds of, some of them are cast iron, some of them are probably copper, some of them are steel. I mean, I'm sure that that's copper over there. And now we have PVC pipe, all of which are different, but all of which are important, I think, for water sources. I asked Rachel that I'll try not to steal her thunder, and I'm just going to briefly mention some things about what we know in the U.S. And I should remind you that every country is different. We do not know, and Jocko may talk about this as well, these organisms predominate in certain areas because of reasons that are not always clear. Some of it with Australia could be isolation. Just like they have some of the weirdest snakes and weirdest mammals you've ever seen, there's no reason that their mycobacteria couldn't be different in some ways than what we have in the U.S. or what we have in Europe. We never recognized that in the past. Japan would be another one. But we now recognize that there are differences, and we probably should expect differences. But at least in the U.S., we do have it in households. A great deal is made out of shower heads, and rightfully so. Shower heads are generally an important source of MAC. But clinical studies of household environments by a guy named Joe Falkenham have shown that basically anywhere that you have warm water, you have MAC. So not only do you have it in the shower head, you have it in the pipe that goes into the shower head. The Japanese don't take a lot of showers, and in Japan, the inlet into the bathtub is their hottest spot for growing MAC. Studies largely done by Joe Falkenham have shown that M. avium of the same genetic type in the household is also present in the water supply in about 50% of cases. Let me just say that knowing the sampling error of taking a swab and going like this and looking at those miles and miles of pipe, the chances that I swab in the wrong place and whatever I grow in that place, the assumption that that's what you're going to get out of somebody's sputum and that's all that's in the water is not right. I think getting 50% is probably a huge, is pretty good considering the potential for sampling errors. Mycobacterium chimera. described by a gentleman in Italy named Tortoli. It is associated with clinical disease. Its importance, it is that by current laboratory methods, it's indistinguishable from Mycobacterium intracellulari. This is a DNA test called PCR, where we make a million copies of a particular piece of DNA that we're interested in, and we make so many copies that we put it on a gel, we can see it. Obviously, one little slice of DNA you can't see, but in this one, there are so many slices that you can actually see it. These first two, and where these bands appear are what we're interested in. They determine the size of what you're working in. The first two of these bands with this particular test belong to M. intracellulari. The second two bands belong to M. chimera. It's not important how we did it. It's only to say this is a test, a DNA test, and intracellulari and chimera look exactly the same. This is a study which was published in the Journal of Clinical Microbiology. I mean, it is a study of the demographics of household water studies for MAC. There were about five studies, lots of patients, lots of households. Some of these utilized water and biofilms. What's a biofilm? If you take a swab on the inside of your pipe and you get this, my gosh, what is this? It's brown, it's rusty, it's cruddy. That's a biofilm. And that's where many of these organisms we believe live. This is a study of respiratory MAC and comparison of standard laboratory methods for identification and molecular methods for identification. And what you should note is the numbers in these individual studies done by standard laboratory methods and by molecular methods for sputum don't show any difference. And part of the reason we don't do these fancy tests on sputum is because we get the same answer. Now, this is a study of isolates from water. These are household water isolates, again, of M. avium and M. intracellulari. So I want you to pay attention to these are the numbers of isolates, same five studies in which M. intracellulari was identified in the water. This is the number of M. intracellulari that were identified by molecular methods. Essentially, all the isolates that we called M. intracellulari by molecular methods were Mycobacterium chimera. Oops. For a long period of time, we assumed that household water was our problem, and that the showers were the problem, and if you could somehow fix that, you could fix your MAC. Oops. There's lots of M. avium here, but there is no M. intracellulari. There is this other organism called M. chimera. So isolates in water thought to be intracellulari are chimera. No intracellulari at all in any of those studies. So why should we be concerned about M. intracellulari? Well, we don't know. We're presuming its reservoir is outside the house. We know that the geography of intracellulari and avium is somewhat different. Some areas had a lot of one, and some have a lot of the other. Means that our work is about half done in determining the reservoir for major strain species of MAC. Avium is in household water. Intracellulari is not. Now, chimera is important, does cause clinical disease, but is much less virulent. What do I mean? People have positive cultures. There's usually very low numbers of organisms. There's no illness associated with that, and it disappears, and we never see it again. My wife, Deanna, she doesn't mind me talking about her in some ways. She had two positive cultures for M. chimera within about a 3 or 4 month period. Not sick, CT not changed. Did nothing, never saw it again. not the usual story you would expect if you had two positive cultures for avium or two positive cultures for intracellulary. So knowing that may change how we approach, because we knew what it was. We didn't jump in with medicines and treat her, and that turned out to be the right clinical decision. Tyler is the rose capital of the world. Little pet. This is another, this is probably something none of you have ever heard of either. We're getting into the era, Chuck, wave it when it's time for me to stop talking and ask questions, because I can stand up here, like Mike, I can stand up here all day. We're learning about how NTM are resistant to the drugs that we use. Why is that important? Well, we can, not all the organisms have these genes and they don't all work. So being able to identify them allows us to make a big prediction about how the patients are going to respond. This is a germ called an ERM gene, an erythromycin. It's got another name attached to it, but it originally was described because it blocked the activity of erythromycin and related compounds. I won't exactly tell you why, but it confers resistance to macrolides, which includes clarithromycin and azithromycin, the drugs you're most used to. This is the mechanism of resistance. M. abscessus, these germs are present in rapid growers, has this ERM41, which is not important. They all get numbers. But here's why it's important. We now have three subgroups of Mycobacterium abscessus on a taxonomic basis. One of them is called subspecies abscessus. It's a big deal in the US. Almost all of the isolates that we see in the US are the subspecies abscessus. They represent 80% of the clinical isolates in the US. But interesting, 15% of these isolates with an ERM gene have an ERM gene that doesn't work. Who would have known? The other percentage of isolates belongs to a subspecies called Mycelliens. It was described by a Frenchman, and I'm sure it came from some town in France. They represent 15% of all clinical isolates, but every one of their ERM genes doesn't work. Who would have known? I mean, it just, when sequenced it, we wouldn't have known. Okay, why is that important? These are based largely on studies by from Korea by a gentleman named Ko, but I think other preliminary studies support this. If you have M. abscessus and you have a non-functioning ERM gene, the success rate of drug therapy of eradicating your M. abscessus is greater than 80%. If your M. abscessus has an ERM gene that works, our success rate is 15% or less. Is that a big deal? That's a big deal. So knowing about these ERM genes and how they work is very important, and testing for the working of an ERM gene is now a regular part of the laboratory. Let me skip. That is my daughter. I come to Colorado every year, and she books time with Deanna and I for at least 4 or 5 days. I think she has a thing for one of the guides. This is the guide shop at the intersection of the Frying Pan and Roaring Fork River. And this is after a tough day on the river. It just doesn't get any better than that. Okay, I want to mention whole genomic sequencing. This is a method whereby instead of studying a single gene, we do all of the genes. You've heard about it for humans. We now can do all 50,000 of your genes, and we can do it in a couple of days. And there's actually some machines that'll do 100 a day. And it's probably more important for cancer than it is for us. So pay attention when you read about this in the newspapers and the magazines about how important that is. It has been based on the fact that we can sequence faster. We have jet plane sequencers compared to prop plane sequencers that we used in the past. It's just better dynamics. In a matter of time, let me just say that we are beginning to use whole genomic sequencing to do comparisons of individual isolates, of particular pathogenic isolates. It is an incredibly exciting advance. NJH has a lab here, which we're jealous of, and we actually came to visit because we want to know more about what they do, which has to do with this whole genomic sequencing. So pay attention to it. You'll see it in the newspaper. Probably not as much about us, but as much about cancer and the changes. This is also about fly fishing. I came to a meeting in Vail, and when we arrived, it was 75 degrees, beautiful. It's right on a place called the Eagle River. That night, it started to rain. By the morning time, it was snowing. In fact, it was right about this time of the year. And it snowed, and it snowed, and it snowed. And my fly fishing gear was sitting in there. So I went and got one of the snowsuits that you can actually fish in. And I actually fished this river no more than an hour at a time before my toes were frigid. But I hauled in the trout because the stream is, actually this is a river, was very small. No place for the trout to hide, and it was worth my frostbitten feet. It just tells you how dedicated we are and how passionate we are about what we do. Fly fishing is only one of them. NTM is the other. Thank you very much.